What's up, everyone? It is your boy Trav Q, and you are now tuned into the Trav Q Show, presented by Fueled by Culture. But we have a special episode, y'all. How do you say it, Harry? What is this called?
It's called a simulcast.
This is a simulcast, so this will be featured on the Trav Q Show, and also my brother, Dante Nero's Man School 202.
There we go.
You can find him on YouTube. And where else?
iTunes.
And iTunes.
And Laugh Button.
Anywhere you get your podcast.
Listen, you can find them everywhere. So listen, well, this is a special episode, and I am very excited for this. Shout out to Fueled by Culture as well.
You think you know about relationships, but you're wrong. Listen, there's no magic bullet. I'm teaching life skills.
Yeah. He's sick. You need medicine. It don't always taste good.
Oh, nah.
But it'll get you better. You need this medicine.
Yeah.
It ain't gonna always taste good, but this is what you need. Men and women, bottom line, we need to have the conversation. Your partner wants to give up control, but only if you know how to drive. This is about being the best you could ever be. Whoever you are, I don't care if you're a man, a woman, LGBTQ, space aliens. I'll save anybody. I don't care. I'll teach a hedgehog how to have a threesome.
What do you mean by that?
Look, you don't have to listen to me, but you're wrong.
Listen, I know I'm great. And I know you're thinking, Dante, there's no way I could be like you. But you could be me. You know why?
Because you know who I was? Before I was me, I was you. You.
Man School 202.
Better hear what I've got to say because you won't get it again.
I'm not an alpha male. I'm not a beta male either. I'm just a better man. Better man.
Well, put your happiness first, because if you don't, they won't.
What's up, GYBB? Get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do? The sexual revolution is being podcasted, and I am excited.
Nice, finally.
Because this is a special show. You know, this COVID shit has been killed. This is the first time we back in the studio together.
That's right.
Since motherfuckers is just taking
for
over.
For months.
It's crazy. It's good to have. How you feeling, Harry? You ready
I'm
to rock and roll?
Healthy so far.
Yeah, so far?
So far.
No sniffles?
Nah, I'm
no
good.
No coughing?
I'm good. I like what you've done with the place.
Thank you, brother.
Since I've been in here. Since I've been gone.
Little things. Little touches.
Got
an
ice machine now?
Got an ice machine.
Yeah,
got
see,
more.
There's a problem.
We're going to get into this beer. There's beer in it. Anyway.
I knew when I was gone. All of a sudden, Dante was going to make
changes.
You know
changes I was going to step it up.
I'm the only one who stops him.
That's it. Hey, new man, lights, everything. It's whatever.
We need an anti-gravity chamber. I don't
I'm
think
trying
we need.
To get that.
I don't think we need that.
Andre's running around, so we couldn't get up when this was a last-minute thing. But we got a special guest. I got my dog, my frat brother, funny dude, Instagram, Vine, doing sketches, movies, all kinds of shit. Yo, give it up for my dog, Trav Q. Y'all, give it up for Trav Q.
What's up? What's up? How's everyone doing?
Goody, good, good. Good to have you here, dog. Also, we got his boy in here, Fred. Fred's in here. Fan of the show is actually the dude that brought us together on this.
Yes, sir.
You know what I mean? Couldn't happen without.
Yeah.
Couldn't happen without him. So
yeah, thank you. Setting it up.
It is. It is, man. It's good. I haven't been here, man.
It's a simulcast too.
We haven't done that. Intro live, like that shit get me hyped like a
It got me hyped too.
I forget you don't get to hear it anymore.
Yeah, man.
Got it in post, but that's one of the downfalls.
Oh man, it's good. Trav, what's going on, doggy? How you?
Oh yeah. Staying humble and working, my brother.
I hear you. So let me just explain how we came up on this. So Fred is a fan of the show. How long you been listening to the show, Fred?
Since like the Black Phillip days.
Back, you've been
old,
that was
beginning. Like,
you know when we did that? You know what year we did that?
Like 05, 06?
06.
Yeah.
Wow.
06, we was on Celestial Radio with Patrice and all that.
That's back when all the presidents were still white.
All
remember
of them.
That? Remember that?
Yeah, that was like, you
it
were
was,
looking.
Before they changed that.
They was looking at little black kids going, you too could be president. And he was like, nah. Son, come on. But it's so we've been listening, and you've been listening for a while, and so you hit me up, and you was like, yo, your frat is doing his thing.
Fact.
Doing podcasts and acting, all kinds. I might have done a little acting at some point in time. I don't know if you...
Maybe fighting?
Have you maybe seen the movie fighting? Fighting? Maybe Blacklist? Maybe. And, let's not go down that
road. John Wick 3?
John Wick 3? Yeah, you know. What are you going to do?
Ocean's 13?
Ain't happening.
Not a lot of people saw
I got
that.
I got edited out.
Oh, you got out.
Yeah, they edited me out.
You still got paid, though. That check went through.
Yeah, it went through. You get paid no matter what. But what you know, that with the game now, Travis, like, the exposure is more important than the money.
Right, right. Especially with this, in the social media era. But I will always say that the money is more important because you can do more with the money. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But it's with because it's social media, a lot of people can fake it till they make it. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's a good and a bad to it.
And what do you mean by that?
A lot of, if someone stand next to $1 million car and put it on social media and said, thank God for this gift or whatever the case, people will think it's their car, but it's not really their car. And like you, a lot of people will probably hit them up like, oh, I see you working. I see you doing
this.
See you doing your thing. Yeah, but they're probably not doing anything. Yeah. So it's like a gift and a curse with social media.
I always say people work on their profile and don't work on their real profile. You know what I'm saying?
Like
they Facebook profile, but they don't work on their real profile.
Right.
It's like you everybody puts the best of what they are on social media.
They don't show what's really happening.
And it was dope. I was watching. I was checking. I want you to know. I was running through your stuff. Funny shit, dog. Funny shit.
That.
But I could tell. You know. And I did a little research. And I some interview. You said somebody asked you like, how do you? So, first of all, how'd you get into the whole doing the sketches and stuff? Was it an accident? Was it on purpose? What?
So I've been this way my whole life. And Frank could tell you that too. Even when we were roommates back in Delaware,
yeah.
This is how I always been. Even in like you know when we went to college together, this was always trap. Right. But what happened was, the first time I went viral on the internet, which was on Vine, a friend dared me to walk in McDonald's and scream, and I said, "Okay, I'm gonna do it."
Right.
And you know, I was like, I did not know the reaction I would get from the people or whatever the case is.
Right, right.
But once I did it, it blew up on Vine, and
right.
That's how my social media career started. It was a different approach, but it worked for me. And from then, I moved on to Instagram, and now I'm doing movies. So I'm very grateful.
How long ago was that? Was that first? That first?
2013. So 7 years ago.
Okay. All right. So yeah. So you've been grinding. You've been
grinding for a long time.
Yeah. And then did you get writers, or did you just stuff that you thought was funny, or what?
It was stuff that I thought was funny, and like. Walking up to a woman and saying, you are one of the most beautiful women I ever met.
Mm-hmm.
Now walk away from me. It's just things that I would do on a daily basis without the camera on me.
So let me say this first. For those y'all don't know, Trav's also a Q. We both Q dogs. And so there's definitely a certain mentality of that. You know, I'm not going to go into the details, but we got fucked up. Harry.
You and Trav?
Me, well,
Let me start by saying Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated is a non-hazing organization.
Exactly. But we got fucked up. I don't know how we got fucked up, but we got fucked up. And here's the thing.
I'm a little confused here. You got fucked up partying, or you got
we
fucked
pledged.
Up
we pledged.
Getting beat up?
Oh, we definitely got fucked up partying. I mean, it's sort of like being a black man in America. Like, you know you got smacked by a cop, even if I don't know you did. You don't have to tell me the story. I know it happened. So, but there's a certain mentality, and you could chime in. There's a certain mentality of the fact that because the fraternity was so wild, it invited those motherfuckers. Like, if you wasn't ready, you didn't. That's not the one you picked.
Do you feel
what I'm saying?
Right.
Like you knew what you was getting into, and you walked in it. You know. Under your own accord, like this is what I want to do, and so that kind of, and you know, like one of the things that I learned from pledging was that no matter how difficult I've ever thought something was, pledging for me was the hardest thing I've ever done in my life, absolutely hardest thing I've ever done in my life, but what it taught me was that no matter what I thought my limitation was, there was so much more that I had so much more beyond that,
right.
You know, in the perspective, I mean,
running
you know,
from it will not save you.
Yeah, it's coming, and wherever you think, oh, I can't do this, when you shut down and go, yo, I'm done, and you ain't done.
Mm.
You know, there's so much more leeway that, and then there's death beyond that. You feel me? So I mean, that mentality, how did that help you with the social media and stuff?
Well. Our cardinal principles, first and foremost, manhood, scholarship, perseverance, and uplift, helped me throughout my life, period. You always have to display manhood. You understand what I'm saying? You have to carry yourself a certain way to Absolutely. Show people that you're intelligent.
Yeah.
You got to persevere through anything. And what's wrong with uplifting a brother? We all should just uplift each other.
Absolutely.
So that's how I carry that to social media as well, because, and that's still helping me to this day.
So you collab with a lot of dudes, or are you collabing, or you just bringing people on, or how are you going about doing that?
Both. Well, most of my videos is on my own, you know, first person, or, you know, or POV. I'm sitting there talking to someone.
Uh-huh.
But I definitely have collabed with a lot of other people as well, too, and brought some people along. See, with social media, a lot of people think because someone has a lot of followers that talent is there, too. And that's not always the case. So I don't aim for someone who has a million followers just to put them in my videos because they have a million followers.
Right, right, right.
If you have 500 followers and you're talented, you're in my video.
Right, right, right.
Because
right.
I want that expertise, and I, you know, I need that talent as well.
Did you have any film endeavors on your own, or this was like, yo, I'm just shooting stuff that I think is funny? It was just came from a natural place.
I think as a creator, we all have something that we want to tap into as far as like filming and creating our old films. But as far as my skits, I would be like, I think this is funny, you know, and I'll just do it.
Right, 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 right. It's what's interesting when you talk about like, you know, you talk about the cardinal principles. One of the things that we, you know, we talk about on the show is ACE, which is our acronym for the show, is authenticity,
right.
credibility,
yes.
and empathy. So, you know, maintaining those principles. And so, you know, you were saying a little bit earlier, you need some relationship advice. So you talked about that a little
Listen, I think as a man, we all need advice, period. And then we don't like to say it. It's like, sure, because we don't like to look at our brother or somebody like, I need some type of advice or whatever the case is. So when I spoke to Fred and I was like, yo, he said, how about this topic right here? And I was like, this is a dope topic. And he said, being a successful man, getting into a relationship with a quote-unquote average woman or a successful woman with kids, how would you adjust to that? And I think, like, me, I need advice, period.
Right,
so
right.
Relationship
is
advice.
Is that on the table now? Are you saying that because that's something that's on the table now, or you're just saying
that's
in general?
In general.
Okay.
Right.
So, I mean, as I think... And so this is interesting, is because when I listen to some of the interviews you've done, it's like a lot of the concepts that you're talking about are things that I've been talking about for forever,
right.
And maybe I've honed them down a little bit because of the fact that on so many occasions, because I got to be able to teach it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's great to say manhood, but then, like, what does that mean?
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
People have different, like, definitions for that.
And if you had to explain what you meant by that, what would you say?
Manhood is the state of being a man, providing for your family, making sure everyone around you is good, and making sure you're upholding yourself in a certain way where people will respect you. So that's my definition of manhood.
Cool. Now, it's one of the things about, you know, like, becoming successful is something, I mean, success and money, it always attracts women, but nothing keeps a woman. None of that stuff keeps a woman. I mean, we see this time and time again. I mean, you know, Dr. Dre getting ready to lose half his Beats money, man.
That's which headphone is he losing?
I'm so happy that we're having this conversation, because I think that you're the right person to answer this question.
It's
why aren't marriages lasting like they used to?
Well, it's
kind of scary.
Well, I think you said your people from Jamaica.
Yes.
All right. So this is an interesting thing about you and I, and me not so much, but we're in an era like we're descendants of immigrants, right? Harry's people are from
half Ecuadorian, half Armenian.
Right. So when you're descendants of immigrants, what happens is your parents they're on survival mode.
Right.
They're trying to survive. They want you to get education. They want you to get a job. They want you to earn. And so the social dynamics of what's really, you know, male and female social dynamics is something that we don't even, that's not even a concern. It's like, go to school, get a trade, get a job, you know what I'm saying? These are the things, because we're talking about providing, because on a base level, we're talking about base level survival.
Right.
They never worried about that. They were so busy, like my pops was born in 1920, so he grew up Jim Crow. You know, so it was
trying not to die on the way home.
Right, you're trying not to die.
Yeah.
So it's the pursuit of fulfillment, it was not even a thought for them. Like happiness.
Right.
You get married, you hook up, you have kids, you make sure the kids don't die, right?
Right.
If they don't die, you win. You stay with somebody. Half the time, you hate each other. You know, parents, I mean, some parents get along, but a lot of parents, yeah, they don't like each other. Black folks wasn't going into therapy. They weren't trying to figure out their own shit. And they're under such a level of trauma. So it's easy to stay together in the context of something where
there's also, legally speaking, back in the day, like, a woman wasn't even allowed to file for divorce, for a while, until almost the 70s. You know, every state had a different law, but basically it was up
to as late as the 70s?
It was as late. That's why there was a big boom in the 70s, uh-huh, of divorces, because finally a woman didn't need the man to say I want it. Even like domestic violence, or even,
yeah, there was a period of time in, yeah, this country's history where you could literally beat your wife legally,
right? Wow. And that wasn't enough for her to file for divorce.
No,
just by the law,
you couldn't rape her. So it's an interesting thing when dudes talk about the Me Too movement. They were like, oh, people are so sensitive, but you don't even understand the historical.
Think about that, getting beaten, and you go, hey, Your Honor, I want a divorce. My husband's trying to kill me. And they're like, he's got to be here to say yes.
You literally could kill a black, yeah, man, and there was no law against killing a black man.
Right.
You could rob a black man. You could rape a black woman. And
you get in trouble for littering if you left a piece of the rope.
But you could,
after you lynched
them, debone me, basically,
right,
take my body parts and share them up like souvenirs, and that wasn't illegal. So so you know what I'm saying? The context, when we talk about this in the context of relationships have become something totally different. First of all, happiness is important. You want to be fulfilled and,
exactly,
happy. And a lot of times our parents weren't really, they was trying to survive.
Right.
You know, so it didn't come into that. But then I think there's this, you know, there was this movement away, like what you talk about, manhood and stuff. Did you grow up with your dad
Yeah, I grew up with my dad. I mean, my mother and my father, they're separated.
Right.
You know,
how old were they when they separated?
I had to be, I think they separated when I was like 4 or 5 or something,
okay,
like that.
So it wasn't really a thing.
Right.
So it's interesting even with that. It's like, you know, what I noticed a lot of times is, you as a young man will look at the relationship of your father and your mother, and then that will be how you interact when you get older.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So go ahead, you was going to say something.
I think, most situations are like that, but I think there are a lot of males who grew up, you know, where their mother and their father weren't together, but they want to fill that void and get that happiness from a significant other and actually be with a significant other.
Yeah.
But the way things are going right now, I think a lot of men are scared to be in relationships. I don't know why, but it's more so like I speak to a lot of guys, and they're scared because a lot of them probably don't trust, you know, being in a relationship.
So let me ask you, when you say don't trust, what do you think it is that they don't trust?
I don't think they trust their significant other like that. Like, that's what.
Okay. Well, here's it's a crazy thing, because like I'll get dudes every once in a while that'll be really about, yo, I don't know if I should trust her. Especially dudes who like to play.
Right.
Dudes who already playing and be like, well, I do it. So, you know, it's a reflection on me. What I think is interesting about that is you really can't get played. And the reason why I say you can't get played is because when you talk about manhood, first thing you was talking about is, you know, doing this movie thing and being on your grind. And so you're already the first. Even I asked you, girl, you want a drink? And you was like, give me something with no calories. And so you're mindful of being the best version of yourself.
Right.
Like you're trying to, you're every day, and I say this, every day, if you get up and put your feet on the floor and your intention is to be the best version of yourself. Win, lose, or draw, that's what your intention is. You get up. I go, you consistently get better. And what happens with that is you become the value in the relationship. So, for instance, you know, like if I'm, you know, when I was, you know, I'm married, but if when I was young and I'm dating, I go, I am I bring the value to this relationship. If she meets me, she's going to go places she's never gone. She's going to do things she's never done. She's going to eat things she's never eaten. She's going to laugh and she's going to enjoy herself. She's going to meet people she never thought she could meet. If she's got problems, I'm going to help her navigate those things. And so it's so if she decides she wants to, like, you know, cheat or whatever, and it's not, and we don't have that understanding, How did she really play me? Because when she does that, all I'm gonna do is remove myself. You know right. what I mean? And so who really loses if I'm the shit and you go, yo, I'm gonna do whatever I wanna do, and then I go, yeah, cool, I get it, I'm out. Now you got all these other poop up motherfuckers that you fucking with, and all these motherfuckers that you thought was dope, and now you looking stupid in the face. It's you know Meta World.
AKA Ron Artest.
Ron Artest. Remember when the dude threw the beer at Meta where he went up and choked the white boy right. by accident?
The Malice in the Palace?
Ron. Yeah. But it was another dude that threw the beer.
The wrong right. guy. He attacked the wrong guy.
But when they looked at the tapes, they found out that the dude that threw the beer, what did they do? This dude was a huge ball fan. He was, you know, he was, just to be that involved in the fact that you would throw a beer at another grown-ass man. But what happened once they found out? They just took his season pass. So here's a dude who loves basketball, loves going to basketball. He got $1,000 he spent on season tickets, and all they did was just they didn't beat him up, they didn't lock him. They just you just can't come no more.
Right. I've heard it when you know Steve Mongo McMichaels from Monday Night Football.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
wrestling.
Yeah.
He's called it taking away a girl's scholarship.
Yeah,
right?
Take away
the scholarship away. Like if she starts acting up and she's creating problems, he goes, "You take away that scholarship."
Yeah. So if you acting up, I take your season tickets. You can't go. You can't sit in the box no more.
Exactly.
And it's fine. Like I get it. You got to do what you're gonna play is gonna play. If anybody get that, but yeah, you lost your
so
season ticket.
So what you're saying is, God shouldn't really focus too much on that. Okay.
If you're
okay.
doing you, right. I mean, think about the success that you have. Doing what you're doing is you doing you.
Right.
Even when you talk about, when you're talking about just running, you know, doing outrageous stuff and yelling in the McDonald's and doing whatever and putting yourself out there, you're doing you.
Right.
And that's where the value is. And so when you do you the party. And if you the party, everybody wants to be part of the party.
Right. And now, see, I'm happy you said that as well. So I have another question, right?
Sure.
So
sure.
For the successful man, you know, how does he decipher? Because I know how to do it. How right. does he decipher from someone who's clout chasing, a woman who doesn't really like him for him, but like him for what he's doing, opposed to a woman who really likes that man for who he is?
Well, how do you do it? How would you do it?
It's just something I know. It's because they.
How
it's,
do you
it's,
define
it's,
it from a person? Forget a woman. It's not just a woman. What it is, I think,
I like
is that. We break rules that we normally use when it comes to a woman. Just like when a woman is being drunk and annoying, if she's hot enough,
yeah,
at least
it.
I used to, yeah, you'll sit there and engage her. And, oh, yeah, no.
Yeah, she bad.
No, I think Obama is a lizard. Yeah, whatever. Right? Because she's hot and you're trying to get laid. But you would never tolerate that from a guy who's just
like, nah, don't mind you calling me the N-word.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Becky, it's fine. I mean, fine. You don't mean it. I mean, you put it with a G-A, right?
Joshua Carter would always go, she got a good heart, man. She got a good heart. Like, if she's just whipping bread at people, like, no, she got a good heart. So what it is you don't use the skills you would use in real life. You don't treat a woman differently when you're using those same skills. So whatever skill, if you, I think we've all been in a situation where you go, there's something about this guy I don't fucking like.
Right,
like a
right,
guy,
right,
I could
right,
meet
right,
a guy right, sometimes right. like for 5 seconds, I go, yeah, I don't like that fucking guy. I don't know why.
Exactly.
Something about the energy. But yeah, we don't use that when it comes to a woman. Because we make different rules for whatever. I think it's just usually because we're trying to get laid.
Because you're trying to get some pussy. So you're willing to trade off
sacrifice
portions of your manhood to
right.
go to get some ass. Mm-hmm. But I think the way I've evolved in terms of how I would always be looking for the red flags, but dog people who are crazy, they cannot be crazy But for so long, it's going to come out.
Crazy doesn't quit.
Yeah, it don't.
It doesn't take a break.
It might take a break. It might go under the, but it's coming. It's coming back. And if somebody is selfish or somebody's unkind or whatever, all you got to do is pay attention. So, like, what I do, what I try to do is I live in abundance. So it's funny because Fred was saying he's been listening to the podcast since Black Phillip. He hit me up. Bong, bong, bong. I was like, yo, well, yo, Fred, what's up? Right? And he's like, nigga, you just, like, like, I've been listening to you. Like, yo, what's up? Like, so, was, who's your man? Da, 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 da. You know what I'm saying? Right, it's just because I'm not letting you change who I am. I'm not going to let this, the fame change me, the money, nothing. I'm going to be who I am.
Solid.
And I want to be able to be comfortable looking in the mirror and seeing who I want, because that's the most important thing.
Right.
And so when you're kind and you're generous and you're loyal, those things are the most valuable things. And when people feel as though the money and the, you know, the, when you get a chick and she's clout chasing or whatever, you, first of all, you're corny. You're fucking corny. It's some cornball shit. Right. I remember this dude. It was a good friend. I mean, not a friend no more because he's a cornball. But he, shout out to Tillery.
Fuck. Could be a lot of people. Let's be honest.
No, I don't give a fuck. But he was like, yo, I got these two. Let's go out with these two chicks. So we go out with these two chicks, and we asked, yo, where y'all want to go? And they, you know, they picked this place that, you know, put it like this. The dinner, you know, dinner was like $500 for four people.
Right.
Which, I mean, it's not that I won't do that, but it's a little steep for a first date.
Right.
And so, but the thing is, we asked them where they wanted to go, and that's where they said we went. So we went.
Your boy and his, the girl that he's going on a date with for the first time.
And, thanks, Eric, for cleaning that up. Yeah. And you know me, I'm always living in abundance. You know what I'm saying? If I got it, everybody else got it. So we eat and drinks and this, and dessert, and this, you know, it's just we hanging out, shuts the, and then, you know, afterwards I didn't really hear nothing from the chick or whatever. I mean, I think he was already smashing his, but it's like, it was kind of corny. I mean, I had a great time because he was my man, and we would have went to that place on our own.
Right.
Just, you regardless, know, Harry and I do that. Yo,
sure,
let's go get a steak.
We go on dates without chicks all the time.
Like, yo, I'm eating.
Always.
It's like, even if you have to spend it on your man, that's your man, so it's nothing. If it's a chick that you don't know and you don't hear from, it's like, yo, hold up. I kind of just spent that bread, like, and I can't hear from you.
But she's a sharecropper, though. This bitch is a serf. I'm going to get me a meal. I'm going to get a meal from a place that I never. Yeah, but you don't understand. If you was a better person, you could have got 12 of those.
Exactly.
You could have. There's so much, but you're corny. Because you got. It's a short hustle.
Right.
You got the short hustle. So it's like. But the sincerity of that, you could. You understand how dope I am? Like, what? Goofy bitch, like,
but they're showing you who they really are.
That's it. You gotta believe them.
That's good news. But that's the thing of, like, you see that, and that's how you go, something a little suspicious. She's not good.
Mm-hmm.
If that's the type of mentality
probably,
that she
has.
She
probably went on a date right after with someone
maybe.
Else.
Exactly. That so. Maybe.
Well, we had shut it down, and them bitches was drunk. But, so probably not this one. But, I mean, the point is really, you live in that, like, when you live that kind of life,
right.
There's more that comes to that. That means you always looking for the leg up. You always kind of shady. You always got, you're never really satisfied. And if you're also not satisfied with yourself, that's why you're trying to get it off for somebody else. So you're a parasite.
Right.
You're a parasite, and you need to suck off people because you suck. And when you beat me out of a, you think you beat me out of a meal. But I would have went and did this by myself anyway. You just happened to be on the ride.
But that goes back to what we were talking about of not doing things just to impress a woman or just for the woman. It should be for you. And if you pick somebody up who's impressed by that, that's okay. Like, you do everything you do for Instagram, not for chicks, not to impress women, for you, for your career.
Yes.
And if somebody's impressed by that, that's okay. But the thing is, sometimes guys like Dante will go to a restaurant because he's hungry. He wants to go to he wants to eat at a nice restaurant. Yeah. He doesn't just wait until, oh, I'll take you because, you know, this is a date. Now I'll spend some money on it. So that's the point. It's not doing it for women. You're supposed to be doing things for yourself, for your life, to make your life better. And along the way, somebody would be impressed by that.
Right.
Like, why would you not want to rock with me? Like, yeah. I don't, like, why would you not? Right. Like
just, I'm the party bus.
But what does that say about her friend as well, that probably knows that that woman is like that?
It's, but you got to understand, I think you also got to understand that people are insecure. And see, even that insecurity, like somebody's trying to steal, she's trying to get a free meal, free drinks, free this for them, because she don't have it herself. Mm. And because there's she has a low self-esteem where she feel she can't really get it herself. It's like, you know, like it's just like you said, I'm not just going, I'm fucking with somebody because they got millions of followers. I'm fucking with somebody because they're talent. And so there's a truth in that. There's an authenticity in that. Right. There's an authenticness in that. And so When you got to be comfortable in yourself to be authentic. You feel me?
Right.
And if I feel good about me, then I feel like I can be me, then I'm not trying to take what you got. You know it comes from a scarcity, right, in your own life. You have this scarceness, and so you're trying to take from people and do things, you know, get something, one leg up. There's a dude, friends of ours, you know who I'm talking about when I say Snake Ass Wayne. It just genuinely has it's always a sidebar, it's always a hustle, it's always and there's always something behind it, and it's that has to be exhausting.
Right.
How do you find happiness in, you know what I'm saying?
There's
even when you walked into the studio, it's like, yo, it's genuine, and that feels, people don't really understand how good that feels to be comfortable in your skin and then meet somebody else who's comfortable in their skin just to be in that same space.
Right.
And so it's, what you wearing? What are you, this motherfucker, oh, you ain't really, you know, it's all this stuff and you're not working on yourself.
People focus on the wrong things.
It's crazy. So when it comes to relationships, you know, yeah, you got the clout. You got clout, and there's clout chasers. But don't come out in the wash, come out in the rinse.
Okay, so I like that. So don't focus on all the negatives. Just stay positives. And once you find out, you find out. It is what it is. And if it comes out, it will come out.
Yeah, and I mean, I think that, like I say, relationships are the easiest thing in the world. You just gotta know what your non-negotiables are, and then never negotiate them.
Okay.
But you gotta be honest about what those non-negotiables are. Like, you gotta be honest about what it is you want and what it is you need and what you expect, and be honest about that.
And you
have
to be willing to have those conversations and willing to go to that awkward place. But once you do it, you know, you become more comfortable the more you do it. Mm-hmm. So the more you're willing to, and you find out that you win more than you lose. We don't do that because we're afraid of losing. We don't want, if I say the wrong thing, she'll leave me. The reality is, if you make a very valid complaint about something and she goes, well, fuck you, I'm out. She was a piece of garbage to begin with, as a human being.
You was gonna get that was gonna be a problem. Right. You was probably gonna get hot grits in your face soon enough, because that's she already crazy. Here's another thing. I think something that I start talking about, just realizing, you have to understand, like, people have mental illness. You know what I'm saying? This is something that we're not even talking about. People have mental illnesses and neuroses, and motherfuckers are getting engaged and having kids and getting married with crazy people, you know, bipolar and schizophrenic and paranoid and all, you know, heavy depression and stuff. And so not even taking those things. I mean, yeah, I need a bitch with a fat ass, and I need, you know, this. I need plenty of neck. I want some neck. I want, you know what I'm saying? You know, it's like, I need this and that. And, you know, she got to cook. It's just, and then you having a baby with somebody who's schizophrenic. Yeah, the first chick that you dating, yeah, that's a, but the other bitch that she becomes, she don't do none of that.
Right.
And you don't know when she's coming home.
Right. You don't know who you're going to get. Who you're in a relationship with.
So crazy.
Yeah.
So crazy.
But it's a balance. You see those things coming. You just have to pay attention. Like, you know, we've talked about it. Like, I know Dante's talked about it. I've never had a drink thrown in my face. He's never had a drink thrown in his face. For you, it's like you're not the type of guy who gets a drink thrown in their face. For me, is I see things coming from a mile. I cut off at level one or something. Like if I feel disrespected. Level one.
Good. I'm happy you said that because my friends tell me that I'm crazy for that. And I'm like, that's she's showing me, that person is showing me who they are. Right then and there. And then it will only get worse. A lot of men, they like to skip the red flags. And once they get into a relationship, it's like, whoa, you weren't this person before, but she somewhat showed you. Or,
she always,
or
nobody's some, or not. For,
with some ladies, that man will show you who he is too. And then they ignore it. So
all
it's
the
like,
time.
Well, that what happens is these Lifetime movies that they make, they're like, he was the perfect man. And then one day he just started beating me with a stick. And you're
it's always something.
Not how that happens. It doesn't happen. There's plenty of red flags along the way.
I call it the shit test. They can't ignore the shit test.
Yeah. You know, and you with some chicks with some dude, and every time they go to Home Depot, he looking at the wood, the 2x4s, and you like, this nigga like 2x4s. Then later on, he's hitting you in the head with a 2x4. You like, I don't know what happened, son. Why he keep going to Home Depot? He keep going to Home Depot.
But it never starts with, like, even physical violence from women, right? I've seen dudes on the street get hit by a woman, get hit with a purse, get slapped. And it didn't start with that. It started with something nasty. It goes back from hitting to screaming to nasty comment to passive aggressive to, you know, whatever.
Hate your mama,
hate
too.
Hate your mom, yeah.
Little dick motherfucker. You can't fuck no.
Right.
You're like, God.
I don't let it get to that point.
I stop it before someone starts talking.
The first red flag is over, and then I know I'm not in the wrong, because I just feel like it's probably going to get worse, and it's almost like
I was gonna say, as long as you feel like it's a reasonable thing, you do have to check yourself and go, am I being reasonable this? Is she doing something unreasonable?
Right,
and you ask yourself that. Sorry, I didn't want to interrupt you.
No, you're good. So, and then a baby comes along, and then now the baby.
Now you're locked.
Now you're locked in.
Right.
You probably don't want to be with this woman anymore, so you try to plan an escape route, but you still want to take care of that baby. What is the first thing this woman is going to do?
She's going to use the baby as leverage.
Yep, and she's going to take you to court for child support. You could probably be taking care of your child, but you know what? She'll go to that court and say, he's not taking care of this child. I want money.
My
boy, one of my boys, he got married, and then he remarried. He had a child with the new wife, and the old wife was like, he was giving her money, and he was like, you know, the first thing I said to him was like, yo, go to the courts and file yourself. So a lot of times, so what happened was, when the judge was like, who is the father, and who filed this case, and he was like, oh, I filed the case.
Right.
So I could pay my proper amount. And she was like, oh, okay. So his, you know, she was trying to take his pension. She was, you know, she was a real awful bitch. This was an awful, bathed in awful. and she, you know, and he, but because of the fact that his intentions was righteous in the first place. He's like, I'm gonna beat you to the punch. I'm gonna go file this, so this is official. Now it comes out of my check. You got, because you know that's what she gonna do anyway.
Right.
You know, if they ultimately, and I mean, if I get that a lot of times dudes try to keep it out of the courts and stuff, but if it's mandated, it's on the pick. I mean, even if you do that, you're better off because of the fact that once it is what it is, then it is what it is.
Right.
Now you're not locked up, and you know what I'm saying? You haven't paid, you're in the rears. The bottom line is, but the judge was like, oh, you filed? I thought, you know, it's because they're so used to women going.
That happening, yeah.
Yeah, and it was just, and he actually, she was more lenient and stuff, and, you know, more. And then she would use the kid to where he couldn't see the kid, because she would use that as leverage. And then she ended up getting in a lot of trouble because she wouldn't let him see the kid. And then he had petitioned the court in the first place. But, I mean, going back to the whole point is that people show you who they are. They're constantly showing who you are. And what we do is we ignore it. And the reason why we ignore it is because we're over and over again, we're in a situation that we don't think that we belong in.
Right.
You fucking with a chick that you think is out of your league, or you think that if she leaves you, you don't have. When I'm always looking at it like, if I leave, you don't have. Because it don't matter whether you got or not. I'm still making your life better.
It's not about money. So you can bring other things to somebody's life.
Sure.
Like even if you don't have money. Listen, I have not had money most of my life. But it's an energy you bring, joy, fun, compassion, caring, being there for her. You know, it doesn't cost money to just be there for her. To get a car doesn't cost money.
Yeah.
You know, to call her doesn't cost money.
Right.
I'm in a long-distance relationship right now, which I thought I would never do until this girl came along, and I'm very happy. But so it doesn't cost me money to watch a movie with her over the phone. You know, we both get on the phone,
get
we'll
on
watch
Netflix,
the same movie.
Watch Netflix together simultaneously. You know, like it's little things. It's the details of those things that dudes won't do where it makes it. But she, you know, his chick is, she's dope. She just like, it's she's always looking to enhance his life.
Absolutely. And it doesn't have anything to do with money on either end. You know, so a lot of guys are like, I don't have money like that. I don't. It's not about the money. Listen, I mean, I've been with women who make a lot more money than me, and right. They were with me not because of the money. I've been with women, it's because I bring something else to their
exactly.
life, and also because I'm working on myself, so they respect that energy and that
and you,
ambition.
You get dudes to be like, yo, I got this bro, she's a lawyer. It's like, you corny, dog. Like, what are you doing? Her law degree don't got nothing to do with you.
Exactly. Right.
Nobody's going, your honor to you, dog. Right. What are you, like, stop.
And I know at the beginning of the episode I said a successful man dating a woman or average woman, quote unquote average woman, or successful
like
woman.
Like a square or whatever,
yeah.
Just a 9 to 5, whatever.
Yeah, so it's no disrespect to you ladies, you know, because I think all women are the same. But it's more so like when it comes, when I say.
Well, all women ain't the same.
Okay, okay. I'm going to correct myself. All women aren't the same, right? But you know how women are nowadays. What do you mean average? What do you mean successful? What is the difference? Because average women can be successful.
Sure.
But as far, what I mean is though, a woman who has a lot going for herself, who maybe have several businesses, as opposed to a woman, you know, just working a 9 to 5.
A little more financially independent.
Exactly.
Right.
So it goes back to, like, when a man is stepping into that, how should he go about it? Mm. And what should he do in that situation?
I mean, I think you just the same way you go in the McDonald's and scream. you show up you.
Right.
And you stay you. And if you is not good enough, it's like if you're working on, like, you know, it's just I say this all the time. It's like if you see a boxer and he did, you know, he's got a big fight and he did his road work and he did his ran his rounds and he ate right and he goes ready.
Right.
You go in there with a certain level of confidence because you're prepared.
Right.
But if you're prepared, you go in with what you got, and sometimes people just don't fit. Sometimes we don't have the same constitution. Sometimes we don't like the same things. Sometimes we like the same things, and then we get to a point where we don't. We change.
Right.
The point is, when you're confident with yourself and you're settled in your own skin, you don't take that offensively. So if somebody says, yo, I don't really feel like this is working, but you dope, you go, oh, cool. I get to go check somebody else out. You know what I mean? Like, you know, like, I mean, this was nice, but let me go experience. You know what I'm saying? But it's, I think people take it personal.
But the other thing with the finances thing, when a woman is making more money than you, we've talked about that. Your job as a man in the relationship usually is to find out what her needs are and take care of those needs. Right. But it doesn't have to be financial. A woman needs protection, but not necessarily financial protection. It could be something else that you provide. Emotional support, physical protection, you know, just comfort.
Companionship. Yes.
So, like, we talked
about. Maybe you're smarter.
Yeah. I mean, that might be it. Yeah, you might be. I mean, literally, it might be handiwork.
Intimacy.
Thing. Yeah.
You know, she liked to cuddle. You know what I'm saying? It's like
we talked about the Oprah thing, which is always fantastic.
Oh, yeah, I haven't talked about it, but, like, Oprah, $50 billion. But she been with Stedman. Stedman's worth a measly $11 million. You know what I mean? But the thing is, now I'm Oprah's dude. So when she's like under the gun, I gotta be strong enough to keep her standing.
Right.
And her Oprah's under the gun was where, I remember when she said she was not gonna eat red meat, and the Texas Beef Coalition tried to sue her because when she said that,
their sales went down.
Sales went down, so they tried to sue her. So she was being, she was, well, you know how you go, big pharma? They was big meat, yeah. Right? They tried to sue her. You, as her man, you got to be the dude that rub her big ass head and tell her everything is going to be okay. Knowing that she makes $50 billion, and she can make you disappear if she wants to. That's being in that position, is having the strength to keep standing up like that is difficult. It's crazy. I remember years ago, Oprah. I mean, this is when Oprah was on, and she goes, her and Stedman go to a retreat. They go to get the puppies, right? And they go to a breeder, right? And he got all these like fluffy white Labrador retrievers. And she goes, oh my God, I want all of them. And Stedman goes, no, you have one. And you like, and I'm like, you just told Oprah no.
You gotta tell Oprah no.
And she was like, oh, I don't know which one to get. He goes, okay, I'll compromise with you. You take one and I'll take one, and that's it. Now, Oprah got enough money to buy an island. Call it Labradoria, right? And pay motherfuckers to take care of life. He can just breed wild fucking Labrador.
For no reason. Just let him run around.
Just do it. I'm going to buy an island. It's going to be Labradoria, right? She had that kind of respect for him to set boundaries for her. And because she's, and that's what she wants.
Right.
Because
and it is about respect. It's not about dominating a woman or like having her under your thumb. It's a balance of respect. Like my girl, if she tells me something, I have so much respect for her because she's never played me.
Yeah.
She's never.
But you also, you never let it. Like
I never let
he
it.
He don't let, like, you know, he would tell his story you just
on
told.
On the weekend?
Like, yeah,
oh,
yeah, yeah,
boy.
Yeah,
all
yeah,
right,
yeah.
So we were, my brother and my sister-in-law, they wanted to go for a trip, right? They got three kids. I don't have any kids. My girl doesn't have any kids, which is rare at our age, right? So they're like, all right, can you watch them for us for the weekend? So we are in deep, three kids, watching them all weekend together. And these, eventually, the kids, you get tired, you get worn out. The kids will start to beat you. They don't want to eat the food. You get cranky. You're not sleeping right. She got a little bit snippy with me. Like, I went to go get a – she goes, can you get me some olives from this thing? We were at a little barbecue.
Buffet,
I got it. She goes, what'd you get a new plate? I was going to give you the plate. I go, I want to give you a clean plate, right? And she goes,
you said you want to give me a clean plate.
Yeah, I want to give her a clean plate. Right. I brought her a clean plate with olives on it. She goes, I didn't ask you for that, right? And I go, I don't like that. In my head, I go, so first I go, did I do something wrong here? I try to go, is she right? I go, this is not reasonable. So I go to the corner. I distance myself, stop talking to her, you know. And then like a couple of minutes, she goes, what's wrong? What's wrong? And I'm not a yeller. I just go over to her quietly. I go, listen. I get it that these kids, that it's tough, right? That we're doing the best we can. I think you're doing an amazing job. I don't pretend to know what I'm doing. I think I'm doing as good as I can. I'm giving it all. I do not like you talking to me like that. It's disrespectful and condescending. And the second I said that, a light bulb went off in her eyes. Like she had no idea that she had done it. And it just clicked. And from that moment on, she was super apologetic. I mean, to this day, she's still apologetic. Like it's been... weeks later, and every once in a while, she's like, I'm sorry, I almost ruined it. It's like, oh, baby, it's fine. I get it. But I don't have to yell. I don't have to scream. But I don't let her talk to me in a shitty way. If it's something, especially if it's something that was just, she got caught in a moment. Yeah, it happens.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's reasonable that you get into a place where you feel kind of funky.
I just had to go. It was an awkward conversation to have at a barbecue or whatever. But
you shut it down.
You gotta shut it down.
You feel a tingle in your nuts. It ain't gonna be long for you before you get kicked in the balls. Yeah. So
you have to respect the fact that she actually had that conversation. She understood. Because
true.
A lot of women would have probably been like,
then you gotta go.
But this is not
the first conversation, and it doesn't happen often. But she is. She's a human being.
Right.
She's not perfect. I'm not perfect. That is gonna happen. The problem is if it starts happening every day and then every
hour and every five minutes.
Yeah. There's no salvaging that.
Well,
I can talk to her.
But what Trav said was funny is because they'd be like, you don't go that way.
Yeah.
Like, it's, what I'm saying to you, don't talk to me like that. Now, if you're saying, I don't give a fuck about you, I don't care how you feel. I don't care that you're uncomfortable. I'm going to talk to you the way I want to talk to you. Because that's if she continues to do that, that's what she's saying.
Right.
Not she may not be verbalizing that, but her actions are saying that's what it is.
Yeah.
And if you're going to do that, then why am I fucking with you?
Right.
I'm not, you know, it's like, why would I fuck with somebody who I know is trying to fuck me? I go that way. You, I said this. This was this chick. We was fucking around, and all of a sudden she didn't want to give a nigga no head, right? So I was like, I just, you know, and I was like, yo, you don't, what's up? She was like, well, I'm just not really that good at it, and I was like, well, then practice, because yeah. That's what I'm here for.
I'm willing to put in the work.
I'm here for you.
Let's meet up after work. Get our sneakers on.
Put
I don't
in
mind.
Some extra yeah. time. I'll spot you.
Let's head to the batting cages and let's work on this.
I will spot you. So we talked about it, and I was like, oh, okay, cool. So she kind of picked it up, and then all of a sudden it started falling off again. And I was like, so I didn't. Now, we've had this conversation. So I was like, I'm not, if anybody know me, I'm not walking around not getting no head. Like, I'm just not, I'm not ever going in life and not getting no head. So she,
for you, that's a non-negotiable.
That's not happening.
Right.
So
some people might look at that as vulgar, but that's the reality. Like, look, this is what it takes for me to be sexually satisfied as a man.
My happiness is right. important, and you're not going to define me. So what? So I didn't say, you know, we didn't. I thought about it. I didn't call her. She called me and, hey, I haven't heard from you. I was like, yeah, I feel like this is not going to work out. You don't really like me. And it's okay. She goes, no, I do like you. Everything's going great. I feel like we communicate well. And I was like, then why was my dick not in your mouth? She's like, why do you have to be so vulgar? I go, because it is what it is. If you don't want to, if this is not how you rock, that's okay. But I'm not rocking with you. It's real simple. I'm not mad at you, but I'm not gonna keep telling you what to do and it don't happen. Because I don't do that. Because if you ask me to do something, I'm gonna do it. If you say, yo, if your name is Michelle and I call you, if I call you Shell and you go, I don't like, or Shelly and you go, I don't like Shelly. I'm not gonna just keep calling you Shelly. Right. Like, why would I make? I make a change. So if I'm trying to get some neck and you don't want to do it, it's okay. That's fine. We could just not do this.
Right.
I'm not mad at you. Just go that way. Like, kick rocks. And I don't even mean it like kicking rocks. It's just, it's the same thing.
Life
as
is too short to settle for something you're unhappy with.
If I'm a boxer and I'm dating a woman who can't. She doesn't like the fact that I fight and that she can't take, maybe she cares about me too much or she's too attached. She can't see me get punched or be, you know, in that physical con. She might have to say,
this is not for me.
I can't rock like that.
This is not for me. But also, you know, when I talk about the things I've talked to with my girl or whatever, it works in reverse. You have to be willing to accept some level of criticism on occasion of like, you know, I feel like we're not spending enough time together. I feel like this is happening. I feel
is it
like
reasonable?
Blah, blah, blah. Is it? You got to ask yourself, is she being reasonable? And there's been times she said stuff that is, and there's been times she said stuff that isn't.
Yeah.
And the stuff that is, I go, you know what? You're right. I'm going to make the change. And the stuff that isn't, I go, that's not what I do.
I just think, you know, Travis, like you ask that question, and the question is really, like, what do I want?
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Like, if you, like, when you look at your business, you know, this whole business, the entertainment and everything, you look at it like, what do I want? What do I enjoy doing? What do I like doing? What do I want out of that? Right?
Right.
And if, you know what I mean? If you want to play in the NFL, you don't play ping pong all year. That ain't going to get you in the combine. You know right. what I mean? You got to do what matches. And it's okay if people are different. You know what I'm saying? It's funny because I want you to talk a little bit about, you know, the way you see yourself is different. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
In that way. What,
different as far as in a relationship or
anything. I think because it's all the same. You know what I mean?
I see myself different with the videos that I do. You know, if you look on social media, my videos are different from everyone else because not too many people are walking up to, you know, celebrities that they see and saying you're beautiful, now walk away from me, or even spitting like rappers' lyrics to them.
Yeah. Because oh, he does this thing. So yeah. He comes to a rapper and does, yo, check these bars out. And he spits their song, and the dude's like, yo, that's mine.
So it's more so what I noticed that when a lot of people get around celebrities is they just want to take a picture. Oh, that's it. Yeah. Me, I'm trying to figure out how can I be creative around a celebrity so it can last longer. You understand what I'm saying? So that's how I feel I'm different as far as my work.
Yeah.
And as far as the relationship, I'm with you 100%. Yeah. Like, it's like, you know, that red flag, the first red flag, I'm like, dang, I can't do this.
Are you being reasonable, you think, though?
Am I being reasonable? I would say.
It's not like, you know, I don't like the way her nails are painted.
I wouldn't do that. I would tell her about it, like, yo, babe, maybe you should, you know, do this color, whatever.
Right, that's not non-negotiable. Right, it's right, more of a preference. Yeah.
Right.
Because there are guys who would be like, I don't know, she had an overbite. She got to go.
That's something that could be fixed.
Yeah, right. Fair enough.
She got big ass knees.
Yeah.
Yeah, but in the relationship, it's more so like, you know, I know what I want, and I know that I want to work on us, you know, so we can excel in the relationship. Mm-hmm. But, you know, things may come along the line that detour that or whatever the case is, and things may not work out.
That's
so
fine. What's your dating history like, kind of? What kind of women do you find that you date?
I date women with nice personalities, yeah, and I'm not going to front. I like women who are very beautiful.
Okay, so, hey, listen. Yeah, yeah.
When you say nice personality, you mean like more outgoing, or introverted, or kind, what? Like what?
Their personality has to be beautiful. That's why I say beautiful people. Their personality has to be something that I can rock with. As far as they could be me, I consider myself an extroverted introvert.
Right, right. What do you mean by that?
So I can go out and I can have fun and I can be myself, but during the party, I need 15 minutes to myself to just sit in the corner. Mm. And that's just me. Like, just to, like, clear my mind and get my...
You need a little bit of a break every once
exactly.
in a while.
Exactly.
So, I kind of get that.
So,
yeah.
My woman could be the same. She could be an extrovert and introvert, but her personality just has to match mine.
What was your dating life like when you were a kid in high school? Because I'm always fascinated by, like, you know, when you first start getting into women, you first start, you know, you hit puberty or whatever. Like, what was it like for you? Were you cool or were you a nerd kind of thing?
No, I wouldn't consider myself a nerd because I went to Sheepshead Bay High School. It was like most of the people in there would be considered cool.
Okay,
so,
wow.
You know, that's something you could do your own research. You could ask any of my friends, but it's more so.
Were you swimming in ladies or did you not have a game?
I had relations.
You had relations.
I had relations, so it was like
you was knocking it down. You had the stat sheet. You put points on the board.
That's fine.
I had relations, but
you had as we. The,
well, I mean, you got
entanglements.
A
lot of entanglements. I had like two or three girlfriends in high school, though. Yeah. In college, I didn't have any girlfriends at all.
See, that's strange. Now, what happened there? Because usually it goes the other way around. Because
in college, it was more so I was maturing more, and I was realizing certain things and. And on campus, like, a lot of women would deal with other men as well. So it was probably, like, throughout my whole college career, there were probably only two women that I actually took serious and introduced to my mother, like, throughout my whole college career.
Okay.
So, but other than that, I never really, like, had a girlfriend in college.
No. But were you getting the numbers up, though?
I had relations.
There you go.
I
love it.
You got to.
There's nothing wrong with
it. You
want to
be good at something, you got to practice. Yeah.
Right.
You got to get the 10,000 hours in.
Yeah, you got to get 10,000 hours eating pussy, licking booty, fucking, you got to put the time in.
Right.
I mean, that's not an unreasonable thing to say. If you want to be good at something, you got to practice.
Exactly.
So I was doing it for you. So I could be a better man.
Yeah.
I'm trying to be better for you.
Well, you please a woman. She's like, that was great. Well, how do you think it got that way?
And I didn't know she was your sister.
Right.
She never told me.
Yeah, statistically, right. I mean, it was bound to happen.
Who would have thought?
But you say that's
I know
the only...
she's your twin.
Yeah.
But that's not the point.
Easily be fooled by that. But you always say that it's the one thing that you're supposed to be good at without any experience. That you're, as a man, you're expected to be good at sex and
relationships.
Yeah, women have a lot of needs. Like, you have to be good. You have to be good at sex. You have to be able to communicate with them. You have to be able to be just everything that they want to be.
Right.
But I think that's why it's somewhat hard for a man because most men just want someone who just respects us and someone we can trust. That's like the key two things in my opinion.
You know what? I don't even think if dudes even map it out. Do you know what I mean? Like, she got a fat ass. I'm in. You know what I'm saying? And then all of a sudden you get stabbed. You know, I mean, like, so it's like, I don't think it's, but you know what's, what I find is interesting is, I mean, the show for the most part is about relationships, but what we find moreover is the same lessons that I would talk about in relationships is the same lessons that you have to have in life. And so if you, if your intention is to, if your intention, if you have good intentions, people know that you have good intentions and right. people accept you. If you're a person who doesn't, I had a dude that I did a consultation with a dude, and he was like, you know, somebody will say something slick, and I'll jump down the throat because it's like she's being disrespectful, and then you know I want to be more likable, and I said, but you don't want to be likable at the risk of being disrespected. What I've always found, even back when back in the days when I was running around and hustling and stuff, there was certain dudes, shiesty dudes, wouldn't do business with me. Because if you fuck me over, I'm getting you.
Right.
I'm going to get, so if you walk in knowing that this, so a lot of times, shiesty motherfuckers will not fuck with you. Women who are chronic line steppers will not fuck with a dude who they know ain't going to take the ain't going to put up with the bullshit. Because right. it's like, I already know I ain't shit. You know, right. I know that I'm. This is why. So why am I gonna put myself in a situation where now I got to deal with this crazy motherfucker because I'm reckless with my. You know, I'm reckless in general, and then I'm gonna be disrespectful, and then I got to deal with that. So you find that when the same way you how you hold yourself, people go, oh, I really need to not fuck with that dude. You know, I need to not fuck with him because if I ain't shit. I don't do shit right, and he's gonna be a problem once I fuck him over. And yeah, so, you know what I mean?
It's almost like when a dude find out a woman is cheating. A lot of dudes respond different ways. Now, I remember when I was young, I was listening to this interview by Tupac, and I listened to a lot of Tupac songs when I was younger, but I didn't understand what he was saying at the time because I was so young. He said, and I'm gonna say it a different way. He said, when women get horny, men start dying. When he said basically when bitches get horny, niggas start dying.
Right.
So I was young. I was like, what is Tupac talking about? I didn't understand until I got older and I seen, you know,
dudes
men
fighting, shooting each other.
Exactly, over women that were cheating or whatever the case is.
It's a tale
is.
All this time. Helena Troy.
Helena Troy.
How many people die?
That bitch Cleopatra.
Helena Troy.
So I think like when men find out that women are cheating, a lot of men, you know, they respond to it in a different manner. And it's like,
well, you know, are you saying, but you know what they're, this is funny because like I was counseling this girl and she was like, she had a dude and the dude was like, she wanted to have a consultation with me and she was worried about this motherfucker tapping her phone. Right? Wow. She's worried about tapping her phone and let me call you from another line. I'm like, dog, like, yo, you understand that the reason why he's so trying to keep you under wraps, like he's trying to keep you under wraps because he doesn't believe he deserves to be there. Mm. You badder than him. He doesn't think that his worth is enough to keep you. So I'd be like, yo, do what you want to do. But if you fuck me over, I'm not even going to do nothing to you. I'm just going to leave. And now you're not going to get the $600 dinner. You don't get the $600 dinner. Now you got to go back to Grape Papaya. You can only get one hot dog and a Grape Papaya. Or you could, I mean, you got to make it worth, just like you got to make it worth their while, you got to make it worth something that they might lose,
right?
Because it's the other thing, and it's not just money, but it's a genuine concern and a like when you have genuine, you know how it is when you have like you motherfuckers is boys, and there's a concern. The first thing he said to me when he mentioned you, that he was like, "Yo, that's my man, and he's doing his thing," and it's. Like it was it came
out the resume, the credibility.
It just came from a genuine place. Do you know what I mean? And because it came, and so that right there, priceless, dog.
Right. No, I definitely appreciate my brother.
54 years old. Yeah. That all that other shit don't matter. But go on, I didn't mean to cut you off.
Now you good. I definitely appreciate Fred because even like when I went to grad school for a semester before I decided I wanted to pursue entertainment.
Right.
And I was looking for somewhere to live. Like literally. I was looking for a whole week. I just stayed in Pennsylvania looking for somewhere to live. Mm-hmm. And somebody was like, yo, hit up Fred. And then I hit up Fred. Fred was like, yo, what's good, bro? Yeah, I got an extra room, whatever the case
Come
is.
Through.
And now, you know, I had somewhere to stay at while I was going to grad school. And he always showed love from day one. And from then, he always been a cool individual. Right, but right then and there, I knew, like, you know, because he kind of, like, took me in. Like, yeah, you can stay here, whatever the case is. You paid as much for the rent or whatever the case is. And we straight. And that was my brother from then, like, so.
Yeah.
I appreciate the love he got for me, and I will always have love for him as
and
well.
I
appreciate you even bringing me here.
It's you got to understand. I mean, we get it all twisted about what's important.
Right.
I mean, and what's really important is, you know, like I'll have dudes, you know, you hear dudes who say this. We had dudes, yo, yeah, she's out of my league. And I'm like, dog, you've already decided that in your head. But here's the thing. If you're kind, if you're generous, if you're loyal, if you're credible, if you keep your word, those are some of the most attractive things that a woman will ever find in you.
Right.
The difference, what happens is a lot of dudes don't know how to sell that. They sell, because a lot of times, especially if a woman is attractive or if a dude is good looking, he's accustomed to people coming at them, or she's accustomed to having, and so she gets, you get, like I'll have dudes that will fuck with me and always respectful and treat me nice. And then I'll be like, Harry, yo, I ran into him, and he'd be like, that motherfucker's a dick. And I'm like, yo, but he was nice to me. And he was like, yeah, he was nice to you. Because
a lot of people are nice to you. You're a big guy.
You cracked that motherfucking skull. So he's the thing about it is so people act different ways when they think you have value. But as soon as they settle in, you know what I mean? Soon as it, like, so if you got some chick and she's clout chasing and you fucking with her and she really just like the hype, as soon as she settles in, she's gonna expose who she really is.
You're gonna
is,
show her true cards.
And you just, all you gotta do is wait. You just wait. And if you're doing what you're doing, shooting videos, auditioning, whatever, you don't have time to track her phone, GPS her bag, you too busy trying to get it. It's all gonna come out.
I don't know. I can't think off the top of my head any relationship that I know of that's ever worked out in the end where someone was doing that. You know what I mean? Where a guy is like,
I know
I'm tracking
one.
Her phone. Really?
I know one. But the one I know, the dude was tracking her, but she was tracking him like they was both crazy. So they was both like, he's
like a bootleg Mr. and Mrs. Smith
type
of thing.
He would like run a bath and wash her real slow with his eyes without blinking, like just eyes drying up. And then she would run a bath and then wash him. Like they was just both weird together.
Yeah, both crazy. They cancel each other out.
Yeah, like if you got two serial
they
killers.
Found out the only people they was talking to was each other. They're like, I cracked into her phone and it was just her spying on me the whole day.
Who the fuck is this? I love you. Who? That's your number.
Yeah.
So you get crazy will meet crazy. You know, crazy will be like if you got two serial killers, they could go kill people together and just have, you know what I mean?
Right.
Just take a picture, selfie, like, yo.
Listen, there were couples. There's been couples that did that shit.
Bonnie and Clyde. You know, but I'm saying the point is, it's got to fit.
Right.
You know what I mean? And it's hard to, you know, years of me kind of settling in and making. Making the steps less steps. So here's who I am. You're out to dinner, and I'm not putting on this front about who I am. This is who I am. If you don't like that up front, then we're done. And I don't because I'm getting old. I'm gonna die soon. So I gotta make sure I can't waste time with people who are not going to bring value to my life. Do you know what I mean? And just as you have this budding career, you gotta. That's the thing. You gotta understand that time is the commodity.
Right.
Everything else, fame, fortune, money, whatever, all of those things, you can't get those things without time. And so you have to start to eliminate people who are unkind. And when you see people do things that are shady, understand that they're not just doing it to somebody else. They're going to do it to you. Now, they may not do it to you because of fear or because of, you know, you're just not in me. Here's a prime example. My boy was like, he was talking to this chick, and she says something she didn't like. Like, she was like,
She was staying over his crib. She got long hair. She would just, all the hair be in the bottom of the shower. So the shower's all clogged up, running, you know, now you live in, you're taking a bower. It's half bath, half shower, right? And she goes, oh, the sink stopped up. And he's like, yeah, but you stopped it up. So it's like he was saying that because she was showing herself, like, the fact that she would do this and just not even consider.
Can you please?
It was like, man, baby, I'm such, what's wrong with the tub? I think my hair went down. You know what you did?
I would just go and take care of it, her hair or not.
But to go, it stopped up. I can't.
With an attitude, too?
Yeah, so it's like,
there's a way to ask, because we will do anything if you ask nicely.
But here's the thing. She was a filthy animal. She was a filthy
animal.
He was pissing on her, choking her, spitting on her. And so he was like, yo,
I'm gonna. Sometimes you got to clean the tub. I mean, you know, you got to make concessions. But you also know, like, hey, this is not going to be a long-term marriage thing.
Or you're just going to have to clean the tub all the time. You know what I mean?
You can still get her ass nice. I think you can still get her ass nice. But you do it the opposite way. Hey. I'm going to stop choking you if you don't fucking behave.
Like, all right, I'll clean it up.
Right? Like,
but he was like, she's a filthy animal. She's a filthy. And so you the trade-off. I have.
What's the statute of limitations on the story?
I'm trying to. Yeah, I'm good. So I go to the chicken strip story. I'm at the comedy club, so I do stand-up, I snatch this joint up, snatch her up, and then we go back. It's 2 o'clock in the morning, right? 2, 3, nothing's open, right? She says she's hungry, so I take her to Popeye's because I'm a gentleman. You know what I mean? I'm classy. So I take her to Popeye's. She gets a value meal. I get chicken strips. So we go in, we come home, just debaucherous, filthy, just sinful, just being debaucherous and sinful. She gets up the next morning, and we both trying to get up and get out, and she's like, she packs up the rest of her value meal, right, which is fine as hers, right. Then she goes, yeah, you don't mind if I take your chicken strips? I was like, bitch, you're taking my chicken.
Nah, what?
How you? It's what I'm saying. So it was like, you see how you say now? It's like I don't really. Look, let's be honest. It's nothing like coming home from work and you got like 3 chicken strips. You throw them in the microwave, right? And then she took the sweet and sour sauce. So she took the chicken strips and the sweet and sour. And I all day long. I was like, yo, I didn't even think I called Harry up. I was like, yo, let me ask you something, yo. If a bitch take your chicken strips, so I feel kind of. It's kind of wild, right?
It's a weird one.
It's a weird one.
It's a weird one. It's not like you gave her the to-go bag or it was her chicken strip.
No, but you're married to her. You got to sign that prenup, bro. She's telling you who she is.
The pussy was bananas. So I was younger. I was like, I'm going. She called me. Yo, don't you come by? Blah, 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 blah. I was like, all right, yo, I'm on my way. And you mean me bring anything in? She goes, yeah, let me get a, could you get me a roll of toilet tissue? A tube of toothpaste, a turkey sandwich, and a Corona. I'm like, yo, this bitch is crazy.
Yeah, that's nuts.
How the fuck?
You don't ask somebody that.
Right. First of all, in my mind, I'm like, it's such a weird request. I'm trying to go like, yo, if you don't got no toilet paper, you ain't wiping your ass. And if you don't got no toothpaste, you ain't brushing your teeth. Why am I bringing a turkey sandwich to a bitch with breath stink and a shitty ass? Like...
You're just fueling some problems.
So I'm in my mind. I'm like, I think I was even telling Harry. I was like, yo, first the chicken strips, and then it was the toothpaste and the toilet tissue.
See, the chicken strips, that's like the first one. You're like, maybe he's just hungry, you know, whatever. But then the fucking weird grocery list.
But I brought the weird grocery list, and the pussy was bananas. So I was like, back in again.
That's a good change. That's a good exchange rate.
A week later. She called me. I haven't seen you in a while. Why don't you come? I was like, she was like, she goes, my debit card, the strip it. this bitch set me up, right? She got my, could you lend me $9? I'm like, yo, I got to get the fuck out of here. I don't know. This was
$9
to,
is a crazy $9 amount of money.
She asked me for $9. $9 is a shady amount because it's enough that you want to ask for back, but it's just not enough that if you ask back, you like I ask, yo, bitch, where's my $9? She's like, right. Nigga, $9, really?
Right. It's the amount that makes you look weird for requesting it back.
So I was just like, I can't. And I don't even know what it really was in the end, but I just knew. Well, here's the other thing. She was like 38 or something like that. She was living with this 22-year-old girl, and she was like, yo, I had to beat that bitch's ass. Now, you 38, 22. I was like, why you beat? That bitch used my shampoo. I was like, bitch, you 38, and you fighting over head and shoulders. What the fuck is wrong with you? So it's like that kind of, so it's you don't know what it is, but it gives you that little bread, the breadcrumbs that you go.
Somebody doesn't have their life together.
Yeah. I remember she moved to another apartment. She was like, could you help me move? I was like, yo, I don't really move in my leather seats. Like, that ain't my thing. And she goes, oh, it's only a few things. And I went and got all her world possession was two garbage bags, a roller bag, and a comforter. I was like,
wow.
And you 38.
Right. That's a lot.
She didn't have all together. So.
Nothing. She got nothing together. Exactly. All of it. She didn't start it.
She didn't really have anything to bring, but you know, her box, and that was basically it.
It was a box.
I mean, listen, it got her four trips from Dante. That's pretty good.
And a tube of toothpaste, a roll of toilet tissue, turkey sandwich, and a Corona.
I would have tapped after the turkey sandwich. I'm not gonna lie. I mean, I would have gone back after the chicken.
Pussy was bananas. It was bananas. But it drove me crazy. Like, right. I wake up in the morning, I'm going to change my chicken. Trav, what you got going on? You got anything going on you want to pump to the fans and stuff? Check out, how can they get you?
So right now, they can find me on social media, Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, Snapchat. All my social media is the same, Trav Q, TRAVQUE. My website, www.travq.com. Right now, I have a movie out called Swag Inc., which is featured on BET, BET Her, and BET Plus. So check that out for me.
Nice, man. Appreciate you, bro. I appreciate you coming.
Appreciate
Fred,
you for having me.
You want to plug your shit?
Yes, sir. Follow me on IG at passport_SAUVAG. And Twitter, it's stat_A_dollar. Two A's.
You don't want nobody to follow you, huh? Interpol don't know his Instagram, dog. Good.
You won't have anyone stealing your identity. That's good. It's going to take a while. But you can go my stuff at Harry Turjanian. That's where all my information is at. Catalyst Wrestling is on every week over at Gas Digital on the Fight app. But also, check out the Man School 202 YouTube page, the Instagram, and, of course, the Patreon. That's where we're focusing on right now, guys. We appreciate all your support, by the way, every single person signed
up
for
Patreon. Don't forget the motherfucking Patreon.
Yeah, I just said it. Yeah.
Did you say it?
Say it again. Yeah, I said it. The Patreon, patreon.com/manschool202. We appreciate each and every one of you, no matter what amount. It really means a lot that you support us and help us keep this show going. Because we've been doing it for a while.
Wow. For free.
For free.
Just suck and win. Like my studio, Trav?
I love it, man. It's dope. It's actually inspiration.
Yeah, we had a lot into this. But everything on my social media, Dante Nero, DanteNero, The Dante Nero. It's on some version. Just go to my website, DanteNero.com, if you want to book me on, book some time to talk to me, consult with me one-on-one. Just click on consult, DanteNero.com, click on consult. Don't forget the Patreon. I've heard these sayings all over the time. Dog, you changed my life. Dog, you changed my life. The Patreon is up. So support a nigga. You know what I'm saying?
And you get bonus content. We're putting
bonus
out extra
content.
Stuff
we're putting
out
extra
there too.
Stuff up. I'm doing listener mail. Or could this Patreon, patreon.com/manschool202. Check that out. GYBB, get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do? The sexual revolution is being podcasted. We are out. Yo, thanks, Trav. I appreciate you coming through, dog.
Thank you.
Love.
Appreciate y'all.
We are out. Man School 202 is created by Dante Nero. hosted by Dante Nero with Harry Turjanian and Andre D. Thompson. Produced by Harry Turjanian. Executive producers Matt Kleinschmidt, Harry Turjanian, and Dante Nero.